Hi, and welcome to our final unit in this course, which is a unit on interactions in biological systems. Here in our first video, we'll look at some general principles of interactions in biological systems. This is an illustration of the inside of one of the simplest cells in your body, a red blood cell, and you can see all of the hemoglobin proteins in this cell shown here in red. I thought that it was a good image to start this unit with because even though red blood cells are among the simplest types of cells in our bodies, they lack a nucleus, they don't have a lot of other structure, they're still incredibly complex. And that complexity comes from the interactions among all of the parts of the red blood cell and the way that those parts then interact with the larger system of our circulation and our bodies as a whole. That's what we're talking about in this unit, is how different parts of biological systems interact with each other. The question that we're going to answer in this video is, how do biological systems interact? In this video, we're going to talk about a different way of thinking about biology as an interaction network, the various patterns of interactions that emerge from interactions among the components in the system. And then we're going to talk about how these interactions lead to phenomena that we've seen before, the phenomena of complexity and emergent properties in biological systems. This video is going to take examples from all over biology that span various different levels of organization in order to get at these larger points. We can think of biology as a study of interaction networks. That's one of the universal characteristics of biological systems, are the interactions among the components of this system. These interactions span various domains of both space and time, but in all instances, it's the interactions among the components of the system that lead to the phenomena that we observe when we study biology. In order to introduce this concept of an interaction network, I thought we would consider a particular biological system. I've selected a plant. We've talked about this before, that a plant has two different systems at work inside of it, the shoot system and the root system. And these two systems interact in order to allow the plant the physiology it needs to remain alive and functioning in its environment. But let's dive in from here and let's look at how the different systems of a plant are themselves composed of interacting smaller cellular systems. This graphic is showing us the various different cell types that we find in a plant, and I've spotlit some of them here. We have xylem and phloem cells that are responsible for the transport of water in the case of xylem and sugar or sap in the case of phloem. And then we have a variety of other plant cells that carry out the other life functions of the plant: photosynthesis, respiration, growth, reproduction. I've spotlit the mesophyll cells here as they're the main photosynthetic cells that we find in a plant, but there are others as well. The interactions among these components of the plant at the cellular level give rise to the systems that we discussed in the previous slide, and the interactions among those systems give rise to the system of the plant as a whole. That's what we mean when we say that biology is a study of interaction networks. At every level of organization, it's the patterns of interactions that lead to the properties that we observe. We can, of course, see this in our own physiology as well, as we look at our circulatory system as an example. We've got major blood vessels, arteries, which feed into capillaries, and capillaries, which then feed back into veins. And it's the interactions of these components that lead to the functioning of the circulatory system, along with the components not shown here, structures like the heart and the physiology of the blood cells themselves. We would not have a circulatory system if we didn't have these interactions happening among the components of the system. You can do this with anything. It's a universal property of biological systems. And it's from these interactions that we get the incredible complexity that we see in biological systems. Biological systems are among the most complex systems that we're aware of in the universe. They're certainly much more complex than any design systems that we have. And this complexity shows itself in interesting ways. What we have here are two different interaction diagrams of two very different biological systems. On the left, we have soil ecosystem interactions among the bacteria that are found in a particular patch of soil. On the right, we have genome interactions in a mouse genome, interactions among the different genes and the proteins that they produce. It's not coincidental that these interaction diagrams bear superficial similarities. That's what we get when we start to study how components in an interacting system interact. We start to see the incredibly complex patterns that result from the sheer number of parts interacting in the system. And it's those interactions that lead to the functioning of the system as a whole. We've talked about emergent properties before, but this is really the root of where those properties come from. They come from the interactions of the components of the system at the level of organization below the level at which we see those properties. The properties of a system like an E. coli bacterial cell, shown here both as a micrograph and as an illustration, come about as a result of all of the interactions of the components that are making up that system. Without those components together and interacting with each other, we would not get the properties of the E. coli cellular system. That's emergent properties, and they result from the interactions of the components in the system, leading to the diversity of living systems that we see on the planet, represented here in a universal phylogenetic tree. Every one of the systems in this diagram is working under the same properties that we've discussed in this video. They're all the result of the interactions among the components that comprise them, and they themselves interact with each other to comprise the larger systems of ecology, populations, communities, ecosystems, and the biosphere as a whole. That's a pretty amazing thing from where I'm sitting, and I hope it's pretty amazing to you too. More than anything else, it's the patterns of interactions among the complex parts of biological systems that lead to all of the phenomena that we've observed to this point in our course, and that will certainly play a role as we discuss the phenomena that we will consider in this unit. But it's important before we end to understand that this complexity comes with a price, and it's maybe put best by Garrett Hardin, who stated his Hardin's Law as, we can never do merely one thing in the biological system. Any change that we make to any component in a biological system will have effects that cascade outward from the point of that change. It's never going to be as simple as increasing A leads to a decrease in B. An increase in A may lead to a decrease in B, but that may in turn affect components C and D and E and onward in ways that we can't even easily understand. That's really the challenge of systems biology, is trying to get a handle on how to understand how changes in one component of the complex systems of biology lead to the kinds of effects that we observe, often many levels removed from where that change has been made. Thanks so much for watching our introduction to biological systems thinking. Make sure you can do the following things here at the end. Make sure that you can describe how interactions at different levels of organization contribute to the properties of biological systems. Make sure that you can explain why biological systems are irreducibly complex. And finally, make sure that you can describe examples of emergent properties that we see in biological systems. If you can do those things, you're doing great. If not, that's okay too. Take a moment and write down any questions that you have so that you can get the answers that you need. Thanks again for watching. I really appreciate it. Have a great day.